to follow Matt after a great morning. I just think it's cruel. You should have started with me, first service, and then Matt. And you know what I was going to do? I was going to run and do a handstand up onto the... But I see you haven't got the medics here, so... I thought I'd better leave it. My hat. Man, guys, it is so good to be with you guys. I love it. Love to see Fiona. The whole crew, Simon, everyone, it's just amazing. You guys, when I walk into the place, I do agree. I don't want to ever come back and see this carpet again. Help me, Jesus. Oh, my hat. Never mind. A new carpet will come. Who's going to pay for a carpet? Anyone out there? Come on. 10,000. Who's going to give 10? Whoa. Okay. 10, 20,000. Done. Carpet next week. Okay. Good stuff. But you know what, God? The Holy Spirit's here. What an amazing anointing. Our Holy Spirit's not concerned about the carpet. He's concerned about your hearts, isn't it? So it has simply been amazing. Good stuff. Today, I am going to speak to you about faith in a God of justice. And you know what? We're going to look at God's word. And I always tell my students, three things you've got to ask. What does the word of God tell you about God? Hello? Then, what does it tell us about us and God's plan for us? Thirdly, what am I going to do about it? And I honestly believe that as we look at the word of God, our faith is going to grow. So, this is such a highly relevant topic for anyone living in South Africa. To be quite honest with you, anybody living in the world, because from the day man sinned, we see the injustice of the whole Cain and Abel thing, where a man just gave a great offering, his brother was jealous and murdered him. And let's be honest, we've gone from bad to worse ever since. Injustice is any action that's unjust, wrong, or unfair, a violation of rights. And I want to tell you this, that every Christian will flourish in an environment of injustice because it's the world that we're living in. The question is, are we going to flourish and how are we going to flourish? So I think we've got to understand that in the last days, the things we're seeing, violence, armed robberies, you name it, all the kind of stuff, the corruption, the question is really this, how am I going to respond? And I'm going to read a scripture in Matthew 24, verses 12 and 14. In the last days, sin will be rampant everywhere, and the love of many will grow cold. And, thank the Lord for the word and, the good news about the kingdom will be preached throughout the whole world so that all nations will hear it, and then the end will come. And I've got a little picture of a T-junction. I don't know if you can put that up for me. Guys, I tell you what, the things that are happening in this world are pushing us down a road towards a T-junction. And every person will make a choice. Either we go the way of not activating faith, our hearts will grow cold, our hearts will go hard, and the Word of God says that people's hearts will fail them because of fear. Or else, we're going to take a turn that says we serve a God of justice. And God is about to do great and wonderful things in our community and in our nature. Guys, with me? Isn't that amazing to think that in the midst of an increase of sin, there's going to be such a revival? The Word of God is going to be preached and everywhere. And I just think about just in Cape Town, just the crowds that came over Easter, the visitors. Last year, we had 2,500 first-time decisions, people who got a Bible. Man, because we trust in God that this is God's time. It's the day of salvation. Guys, one of the keys to seeing the hand of God in an environment of injustice is faith. And you know, it came out in the song we were singing. Faith is simply trust in God and belief that He will act in a supernatural way. Do you believe God will act supernaturally on your behalf? That's a question. Because this God that you believe in, you've got to understand the theology and believe the theology that He is all-powerful, He is all-knowing, He is omnipresent. He's everywhere at once. He's eternal. And I believe above all else that He's good. Can you imagine if God was all those things but He wasn't good? That He woke up one day in a bad mood and just said, bzzz, and blitzed us. Bzzz. All you people in Durban, to hell, off with you. Bzzz. The Bible says He's loving, graceful, and merciful. We believe, a person who has faith in God believes that God has wonderful plans for us as a nation and as individuals. I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. And they're not plans to harm you. You've got to believe that this God that you serve is not a God of injustice. That He causes all things to work together for good. I'm going to read the scripture. It's one of my favorites. It's got to be one of yours. Romans 8:28. And we know that God causes one or two things to work together. Everything. Say that word with me. Everything together for the good of those who love God and are called according to His purpose for them. Guys, for heaven's sake, love God. It's as simple as that. Love Him. Embrace your calling. And He will cause everything to work together for good. Guys, you've got to understand the goal for spiritual growth and maturity is to grow in faith in every area of our lives. Now, I know I said it before the last time I came. We are people who compartmentalize. We compartmentalize our faith. You'll have a person who absolutely believes God for finances. I know God. Well, I trust Him. But they don't believe God for safety and protection. It's interesting how there'll be one spouse who's always worried about the kids. Will that be safe? Will that be all right? The husband says, trust God. Oh, he said, you just don't care. Trust God. He said, you're not worried about our kids? Then maybe the other person just trusts God for gifts and miracles. They'll pray for the sick. I tell you what, a lot of Christians don't have faith in God for justice. They're emigrating in their crowds. I've been overseas quite a bit. There are colonies of South Africans. And you know what? This is an interesting story. A few years ago, before I started our Bible college, I remember I came up and spent a few days with Tash. I asked my sister to organize me to visit different churches in her city where there was a Bible college. You know, we chatted about it. And then he said, you don't mind me talking about the South Africans in our church? Every time, it was a miserable story of miserable people who were causing trouble. You know what? You take your lack of faith with you. Guys, I'm not saying there's anything wrong with emigrating. I'm actually not. Don't hear what I'm not saying. But if you leave your country or you leave your city for the wrong reasons, the blessing of God is not there on you. Do we have faith for justice? What is justice? Okay. It's that which is right, or as it should be, in terms of God's law and God's principles. I'm primarily talking about. It means behaving in a way that is morally just and fair. It means to be impartial. Injustice is obviously behavior that is wrong, immoral, or unfair. Can I say this? Justice is a preferred future. It is a better life. And we, you know, God's justice was poured out on Jesus Christ so that we can be declared just and have a preferred future. I've had many challenges in my life, but man alive, if I experienced the blessing of God in so many incredible and wonderful ways, justice is a preferred future. But listen to this. Faith in God activates that better future. Faith in God will activate a better future for you, for your family, for the city, and for this nation. Faith for justice, in a way, is a no-brainer because justice is one of God's main attributes. God cannot help himself. He's just and righteous. Shall I read you from the Word of God? Deuteronomy 10, verses 17 to 19. For the Lord your God is the God of gods and the Lord of lords. He is the great God, the mighty and awesome God, who shows no partiality and cannot be bribed. He ensures that orphans and widows receive justice. He shows love to the foreigners living amongst you and gives them food and clothing. So you too must show love to foreigners, for you yourselves were once foreigners in the land of Egypt. We serve a God who looks after widows and orphans. Deuteronomy 32, verse 4. He is the rock. His deeds are perfect. Everything he does is just and fair. He is a faithful God who does no wrong. How just and upright is he? Guys, if you need justice, for heaven's sake, turn to the God of justice. Are you guys with me? You see, we often struggle to have faith for justice because ever since man has sinned, the world has been overwhelmed by a tsunami of injustice. People have almost been overpowered. There's so many women who've been enslaved and abused and locked up in situations that God never intended. People have been trapped, for example, by apartheid, racism. And what happened is that people have become cynical and negative because in their own eyes, they see so little true justice. You've got to know that injustice is a product of rebellion against God. And what I'm going to do, just very briefly, I'm going to give you my definition of how people become unjust. Will you bear with me quickly? I believe it's pride plus selfishness plus fear leads to deception and then injustice. Firstly, pride. You see yourself as better or more valuable than others. In other words, to place a higher value on yourself, your family, your race, your tribe, your nationality, or your class. It's so interesting. I know people who are crooks. I tell you what, they love their family. They're great fathers. And all they rip everybody else off to help and look after their family. That they just place that higher value on their family. So when you place a higher value on yourself, you place a lower value on other people. Guys, you got to understand that. That's why we say in the church, we're all equal. Everybody's welcome. We don't create statuses. You don't call me the Apostle Dr. Reverend Graham Evans. I'm actually really quite upset. Okay. So when people are devalued, you humiliate people. Then secondly, selfishness. Pride leads people to think they are entitled to much more than others. Guys, entitlement, never think you are entitled. We live in a generation of entitlement. I'm entitled to that. And I tell you what, it's going to lead to a, you talk about a tsunami of sin. There's nothing more sinful than entitled people. They will take what does not belong to them because they feel entitled. We see that during wars. Second World War, Germany decides we're entitled to Poland, entitled to that country. Apartheid, a white minority group feels they're entitled to own all the land and to take ownership away from anybody who is black. Think about it. That's selfish. Many people convince themselves that they are entitled to that which they don't deserve. I'm entitled to screw you because I think I need a boat and a house and 4 holidays overseas. So I'll rip you off. Because people think like that. Then the third one is fear. Proud, selfish people fear, always fear losing the privileges, benefits, and lifestyle that they enjoy. So they act unjustly. And the Israelites, Pharaoh feared the Israelites, so he enslaved them. It was fear of a people who were growing and were becoming wealthy, and wealthy and healthy. Fear drove people to keep apartheid going when they should have dismantled it. Pride, selfishness, and fear. The Bible says that perfect love casts out fear. By nature, God is a miracle worker because he loves to rescue. Guys, we will not be dominated by fear. Psalm 77 verse 14, you are the God who performs miracles. You display your power among the people. Guys, we've never got to never forget that Christianity is a miracle religion. Back at View Church, we get people to fill in prayer cards. We pray over them in every possible context. We see the miracles. We believe, we trust, and we see crazy answered prayers all the time. Somebody who doesn't even have the right plumbing has a baby. That's a miracle. No, we serve a miracle working God. Guys, do you not expect a miracle in South Africa? If we're serving a miracle working God, why can our God not do something incredible in this country? God wants us, guys, listen to me, to fight fear and discouragement. Do you know that when you allow yourself, even as a Christian, into fear, without even understanding what's taking place, you could find yourself being unjust. You start withholding. You start protecting. You stop being generous. It's unjust not to be generous, isn't it? 2 Timothy 1 verse 7 says, God didn't give us a spirit that makes us weak and fearful. He gave us a spirit that gives us power and love, and it helps us control ourselves. You know, we were all so gripped. I was so angry when I woke up and found that at about midnight or 1 in the morning, our president had changed his cabinet. And then I stopped. And I said, Evans, you know, I always use my surname when I talk to myself. Don't call yourself Joey, Timmy. It's Evans. Sort yourself out. And I said, you know what? If I submit to fear and discouragement, I do not have faith in a God of justice. And you know what? I walked in with fire into that staff prayer meeting on Friday morning, staff and students. We took hold of the word of God. We spat it out. We declared it. We proclaimed the word of God. We began to pray. One of my staff, man, that prophecy, I keep saying, please write it out. She said, I see a South Africa. I see free education. I see this. God, it was like such an anointing. What do you see when you look at our country? Do you see justice? Do you see fairness? Do you see the blessing of God? Do you see criminals turning to God? Do you see our streets safe? Some of you are saying, oh boy. Sorry, that's a bridge too far. Come on, guys. You know what? It's only possible to combat injustice through faith in a living God. A living, just, righteous God. Hebrews 10 verse 38, the New King James, now the just shall live by faith. God, we are, guys, we are just. We are, God regards us as just because of the blood of Jesus. And you know what? Can I be honest with you? We all have wobblies, don't you? Something will happen, something in the Sunday Times, something on the news. And I just think, flip, where's the embassy telephone number? Have you never thought that? I'll even get on the slow boat to China. Let me just get out of here. The devil, you know, the devil never stops talking. You've got to tell him to footsack. He understands Afrikaans, I promise you. You know something? When I've been overseas and there's just been people, Jenny and I just walked up to the first black person. Can we just say hello to you? Oh, please. Yeah, you know what? Those of us that are white, we like it. But you know what? We whites can be insipid. This is, where do you come from? You look like a South African. No, come from Ghana. Okay, but anyway, we should shake our hands. Come on. Anyone experience that? Guys, come on. We've got a vibrant country. We've got something in South Africa. And let's trust God that God is going to do something amazing. Okay. Now, I want to talk to you about injustice and justice from a biblical story. Have you ever heard of the book of Esther? Okay, I'm going to start off with by telling you a story of ongoing injustice. And isn't it amazing when injustice starts, you can see it at the work, the guys are ripping off, taking the money, doing this, and you just think it just doesn't stop. And it almost appears as if God doesn't see it. So let me tell you the story. During the reign of King Xerxes of Persia, what had happened, the Israelites, God used Babylon to defeat the people of Judah and to take the people into captivity. But because they dishonored God's people, he had them wiped out by the Persians. That's a shame. Poor Babylonians did God's will, but because they were sinful, they were wiped out. So you've got the poor Israelis living kind of in the kingdom of Persia. And at that time, there was a king called Xerxes. He was a cruel tyrant. Actually, his proper name was Xerxes because he was quite a jerk. Okay. Anyway, Xerxes, one day, yeah, he was such an egotistical man, male. Ladies all say, yes. What he did was, he had this beautiful wife called Vashti. And he was having this party and the guys got all drunk. And then they were, you know, when guys get drunk, they get horny and all the rest. So he says, you know what, guys? I'm going to get my beautiful wife and she's going to parade in front of you. Vashti, you know what the Queen Vashti said to the king of the world? Go and fly your kite. She says, go and play in the traffic. If you think I am going to walk and parade myself in front of your dirty friends, forget it. So you know, being unjust, he banished her. He was Xerxes. First big injustice, second injustice. His friends say to him, why don't you just have a beauty contest and just find the most beautiful girl? You deserve it. So big beauty contest, he chooses a girl called Esther. But you know what? She never told him that she was Jewish. Second injustice. The Jewish people were treated as second class citizens. And she couldn't bring herself to tell him and his officials that she was Jewish. How awful to actually have to hide your nationality and who you are. Just because of just plain injustice, prejudice, call it what you want. Next injustice. Just looking at Esther's life, her parents had died. She was an orphan. She was adopted by Uncle Mordecai. And Mordecai worked as a government official at the gates of the city of Susa. And the story gets quite complicated. One day, Mordecai heard some men, he overheard them sharing their plot to assassinate the king of Persia. Even though this man was unjust, he was loyal. What he did was he went and told the officials of the plot. And they caught these guys, got them to confess. And as was required by law, this story of Mordecai was written into the history of the kingdom. But because he was Jewish, they decided not to honor him. Anybody else would have been honored. Injustice. Always injustice. Then there was a nasty, horrid man called Haman. He was unfairly promoted by the king to become one of the most powerful officials in the empire. It was like a suction. Tell me, how many of you guys have worked in a place where some guy or lady was unfairly promoted? Have you ever had that experience? You just think, what's wrong with the boss? Can't he see? Can't he see what a nasty, horrid idiot? And this guy or girl just gets promoted. Everyone wants to know, well, what did he or she do to get promoted? And often these people are unable to handle the new authority level. That's exactly what happened. Haman demanded that everybody who walked past him should bow to him. What a jerk. Xerxes number two. That's why he was friends with Xerxes. So what happened was Mordecai was a man of dignity. And he said, you know what? I am not worshiping another man. I'm not bowing down to him. So Haman, he just became extremely angry. And we just find that there was just unjust injustice just brewing. Now, Haman hated Jewish people. And it's very interesting. It actually goes back centuries beforehand. He was an Agagite, okay? And they were bitter enemies of the Jews. And God instructed the king to kill, to wipe them out. But you know what? The king felt sorry. And he didn't kill the Agagite king. And he bore descendants who came down to Haman. And Haman decided that he was going to wipe out every Jew. So what he did was, because of his authority, he had the seal and he somehow persuaded Xerxes to sign a decree. And a decree that was signed by the king could never be overturned, that on the 7th of March, every Jew in the whole world would be killed on that day. So yeah, we just see massive injustice just everywhere. It was like a peak. And then what he did was, because of all the hatred. Now, it's interesting, this whole thing about wiping out the Jews. If you read the history of so many battles and brutal wars, it goes back to offenses that took place centuries before. It's hatred, ungodliness. And we see that all over our world. He decided to build this massive gallows on which he was going to execute Mordecai. And he arranged to visit the king to get him to sign for Mordecai's execution. So guys, what have we got? Injustice, 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 injustice. Have you ever found yourself in that position as a Christian? You think, when is this going to end? Maybe in our own country, you're thinking, when does all this end? How does it end? What's going to happen? Injustice, corruption, injustice, injustice. But then, guys, enter the God of justice. The God of justice. You know what happened? Mordecai stood up and made a decision to fight for justice. Can I say this? God is going to change our nation when the church stands up and says, we are taking a stand for justice. God is looking for a man, he's looking for a woman, he's looking for a church that will trust the God of justice. And what he did was, he began to think, maybe Esther has been made a queen. And you've got to understand, her being a queen, ha ha, meant she joined the king's harem. Who would want to be a queen? Who'd want to be a queen on that basis? And so he sends a message and says, you need to speak to Xerxes and tell him what's been done, that there's a decree that we all be killed. Anyway, she knew that the law was if you walked into his bedroom or his private area, you were automatically executed unless he took the golden scepter and held it out. Anyway, a conversation takes place. And Mordecai says this, chapter 4, verse 14, who knows if perhaps you were made queen for just such a time as this. I want to ask you, why were you born when you were born? Why are you living today? Why weren't you born 100 years ago? Who knows that you might have been born for such a time as this? There's been so many words, too many words that have come from men and women of God in times of anointing for me not to believe that God hasn't got an amazing revival plan for this nation. I believe that I'm still alive, that I'm healthy, because God has raised me up for such a time as this. I have never been so excited about the future. Amen! Come on! You are amazingly blessed to be living in South Africa now! You say, Haman's still alive. Xerxes is still there. He's still jerking people around. No. Okay. You know what she said? I want you to call everybody into prayer and fasting. And I'm going to go in. Can I tell you the power of prayer? We've realized back home that you cannot get around a good, solid time of connecting with God. You know what? There's a God of justice. There's a God of righteousness just waiting for us. You know what the Word of God says? I repeat this. You have not because you ask not. You can complain about people in authority, but have you prayed about it? Have you? Have you prayed? If you prayed, thumbs up. Thumbs up. Because it started a series of miracles. First miracle. Xerxes held out the gold scepter. He showed crazy favor. Honestly, I believe that God is going to save our country through giving people favor. And I never talk politics from the pulpit. I believe God wants to raise up men and women in the political arena, and he's going to give them favor. She got favor. And the king says, what would you want from me? She said, can I have a banquet just for you and Haman? First amazing breakthrough. Second one, the king discovered that Mordecai had saved him from assassination. He couldn't sleep one night. So he got out the history book. How many of you know that if you read a history book, you're going to fall asleep? Okay. And he pages through, finds the story of Mordecai and realizes that he was never honored. At that moment, the next morning, he gets up, Haman comes in. Haman's come in with a letter for Mordecai's assassination. But before he can ask, the king says, look, what would you do for somebody that really deserves honor? So he thinks he's talking about himself. He says, get the best horse, the robe, the king's ring. Just parade him around the city. He said, thanks so much for that advice. Will you please honor Mordecai? Because what a miracle. I want to tell you, God can turn any situation around. Third justice miracle. The banquet takes place. The king invites Esther to make her request. He hadn't forgotten that she had a request. She said, I want to talk to you about the Jewish people. I want to tell you, first of all, I'm Jewish. And I want to tell you that a man has got you, without you realizing it, to sign a decree for all of us to be murdered on the 7th of March. The king says, what? Who's that person? Haman. You know, the king was so angry, the word of God tells us, that he went outside. He was fuming. He just picked up his packet of cigarettes, went out, smoked a couple of cigarettes just to calm down. Meantime, Haman can see the writing on the wall and he wants to go and beg Esther to save him. He trips and falls on Esther. Let me tell you, the unforgivable sin was to throw yourself onto a queen. In that moment, the king knocks out his cigarette, walks in and sees it and says, right, buddy, you're going to be executed. He was executed on the very gallows that he had established for Mordecai. Guys, I want to tell you, we've got to stop believing that injustice rules forever. Because we believe it. We just believe there's no justice anywhere. The Word of God tells us that Scripture is there for our benefit, to instruct us, to teach us. Okay, fourth miracle. The king gives all of Haman's property to Esther, and his signet ring goes to Mordecai. You know what Mordecai did? He signed a decree that overturned the previous decree. And this new decree said that all Jews were entitled to resist their attackers and their enemies. And many of their most dangerous enemies were killed on that day, including Haman's sons. Guys, what a turnaround. Fifth miracle. Xerxes became Xerxes again. He promoted Mordecai to become his prime minister. Second in charge of the kingdom. Doesn't that remind you of Joseph? Guys, do you know what? These people, including Joseph, had to undergo endless injustice so that God could use them as agents of justice. Incredible, isn't it? Guys, in closing, I want to look at our faith for justice in three areas. Firstly, if you as an individual or as a family have been subject to injustice. Guys, our churches, our nation is full of people who've experienced xenophobia, political violence, unfairness, injustice in the workplace, fraud, corruption. Have any of you ever been defrauded? It's a terrible thing to find when someone defrauds you and you're using your credit card. Unfair treatment in the family. Disinherited. Corruption in sport. Guys, I don't want to go on, but I want to say this. No Christian is ever a victim. The God of justice, who is faithful, loving, and fair, is on your side. Guys, if you don't believe God's on your side, I'm asking you kindly to repent right now. Say, God, I apologize. I repent of being a victim. The minute you become a victim, you totally submit to injustice. And you forget that you're serving a God of injustice. You know, my brother, Jenny and I hadn't been married long, and he lost his job. He was building a house. And what happened was the company had been bought out. His boss, in those days there was no labor law, just decided that he wanted to put a friend in my brother's position. He was an accountant, just fired him. And my brother was out of work for a while. He got another job. But you know what happened a few years later? That company was taken over. And the boss who fired him was fired, and he was placed in that man's position. Guys, how weird. How weird. Guys, I want to tell you, God will give you justice. But guys, you've got to have faith. You've got to love him. You've got to serve him. Second aspect of justice. Do you know that we're called to be God's partner in justice? And you might have been a person who's been through injustice, but you know God will use that injustice to strengthen you and to give you a heart for other people. Joseph, man alive, sold by his brothers, made a slave, unfairly placed in jail, you name it. But you know what? God turned that round for good, that not only did he save his family in the end, but he saved the world. A type of Jesus. Esther, an orphan, slave nation, despised Jew, adopted by her uncle. God turned that around and she became his agent of justice. She was positioned by God. I want to ask you, are you allowing God to position you to be his partner in justice? Guys, I don't have time, but that's a serious question. What does the Word of God tell us about God? What does it tell us about us? We're certainly not victims. God cares. But are you and I willing to say that in whatever way possible, whenever way God opens a door, we're going to partner with him? And I know at View Church, we've got all kinds of things. Finishing strong for education, providing food, feeding programs, looking after the vulnerable. We want to build a clinic, which I believe will become a hospital. And we're seeing miracles take place because we have declared that we will partner God in justice. Guys, there's so many amazing little scriptures that talk about God's love and care for people who look after widows and orphans. You know that in James it says true religion is looking after widows and orphans and living righteously. Did you know that? Thirdly, guys, can I just end on quite a sober note? It's so easy for us to give in to pride, selfishness, and fear. I want to ask you, have you ever acted unjustly and need to repent? Zacchaeus, hiding in a tree, one of the most corrupt men in the nation, Jesus said, I'm coming to your house. I want to talk to you. I want to connect with you. He walks out and says, I'll pay back four times that which I've ripped people off. And I want to give half of my possessions to the poor. You know what he said? What did he say? Just hold it. He called him, what is it, a great son of Abraham. Okay, we haven't got time to go on. We find it. Yes. No. Anyway, it's all there in the Word of God. David repented of stealing somebody's wife. Haman didn't repent. Can I ask you this? You got people working with you. Are you working for you? Are you paying them fairly? I've challenged South Africans head on. We have a culture of not giving salary increases because we need to buy our new motor car or the overseas holidays become expensive. So keep salaries down. Listen, the lady that works for us, she's got DSTV, the full package. Yes. Premium. Because she doesn't like the smaller packages. She doesn't have a husband. She's on her own. She has got DSTV. Our staff, we decided we're going to trust God. They get medical aid, they get pension, they get gap cover, and they get life insurance. That's what we pay for. And you know what? God's blessed us. I'm not saying you must do that. I'm just asking you. I'm asking you, are you looking after the people who work? If you've got a business, do you pay your people well? Do you bless the people you work with? I had a family member that took his family on a 2-month holiday to America and canceled all the bonuses for his employees. A lot of people do that. Don't go, that's standard. That's standard in this country. You know what? If we want God to bless us, we have to become just. And on that sober note, let us pray. Father, we first of all just want to thank you. Oh God, you're such an awesome God. You're a mega God. You're an amazing God. And I thank you, God, that we can have a faith in a God of justice. God, every person sitting out, everyone that we're relating to at work, at home, we can declare to them, I am going to pray for you because my God is a God of justice and he will give you justice. He will give it to you. He will turn things around in our country because we believe in God. Guys, with me. Lord, I just ask you, please, God, that we will leave this place with such a firm belief that even when we have injustice after injustice, we can trust you for a day when you're going to turn it around and we're going to see justice after justice after justice, because that is who you are. But then, God, as we close, I pray, God, that you will forgive us. And God, the greatest injustice we commit is not giving our heart to you. Because God, you punished your son in the cruelest possible way that we might have eternal life. God, the most just thing we can do is just give our hearts to you. Because I'm just asking you just to let God speak to you in this moment. I think Matt said something this morning. When we point a finger, three fingers point back. You might be so upset about stuff you hear about. But are our hearts clean? Do our family members, do the people we work with know us as being just? That we're fair, we're impartial. God, I just pray, just give us a brand new heart of justice. I just wonder as we close, because time has run away, if you are here and you know that you need to give your life to Jesus, I want you to raise your hand because I'm going to pray for you. We serve such an amazing God. Grace, mercy, sent his only son to die. And as you say, Jesus, give my life to you, he will change your heart. Is there someone here tonight? You want to say yes to Jesus? Because I want to pray for you. Father, I thank you for this time we've had. Bless us, inspire us, uplift us. In Jesus' name, amen.